So let's enable DNS login here. So first thing you need to do is you're on your domain controller, right? Can everyone see Frank's screen? So in your domain controller, what you want to do is bring up group policy management on your machine. So under group policy management,
Taking this area.
So you could do this under default domain policy, or you could just create a policy. So if it's your lab environment, just use the default domain policy. That'll be okay. So if you edit the default domain policy,
Or can we just build a new one in here?
we can. So you can right click the root of your domain. So what? Because again, this policy is going to be applying to your DNS servers, right? So for most people in your environment, your DNS servers are the same as your domain controllers, right? For most people, typically in your environment. So you, if you right click the domain controllers OU, and then create a new GPU and link it there. So the domain controllers OU, the one at the top. Yeah, so just create a new GPU and link it there. So call it something like DNS auditing or something like that.
Oops. Too fast.
So after you go to DNS auditing, so then what you want is go on the computer configuration.
Am I in the right spot? I need to edit it here.
Yes, so you need to edit it to bring up the editor. So now go under computer configuration, under policies. Oh, sorry, under Windows settings, policies, Windows settings. Under security settings. So that's one thing to pay attention to is that your login is usually under security settings. So go under local policies, and then under audit policy. And the policy that you're looking for is audit directory access. Audit directory service access. No, before you enable that, so if you bring up a command prompt, so I'll show you how to check, like in your environment, if you want to check if that's enabled. So if you type in audit poll, press enter to that, and let's see what that comes up with. What options do you get there? So, what are the options that you get?
Audit poll will be slash get.
Yeah,
We got
okay.
slash.
So use audit poll slash get, then forward slash category, then forward slash category, then colon star. So audit poll, forward slash category, then colon after category, then the star.
Cool.
So that's
Oh, like this.
then start that. So I can't see that. So
Required privilege not held by
so you
the
need to run that as admin, run
client.
PowerShell as an admin, or run command prompt as an admin. So in case you want to see what's enabled or not enabled in your environment, if you run that, so if you scroll down to where it says DS access,
DS access.
so that'll probably be way down there. There you go. So DS access, so that directory services access. So you can see that by default, the auditing is not enabled for directory service changes. For detailed directory service replication, that's not enabled. So it's enabled for access, but it's not enabled for any changes. So that's the policy that we want to enable now.
This one here.
So we could enable it on a machine basis, but what's the point on enabling it on a machine basis? What you want to do is create a group policy for it and apply it to all your DNS servers. So if you go back to group policy and just enable that policy. And then for success or failures, that'll be good. And then okay. and then apply that. So then if you do a group policy update on your domain controller now, and then if you check audit pool now, it should be showing that now you have that auditing enabled. Now, but then the thing that we've done is we've done the very first part, which is the enabling the policy on the server itself. So this is saying to the event log, now you can log this. But now you've not enabled that on DNS itself. So then that's the next part that we have to do. So if you scroll down now, yeah, so you can see that that's enabled. So on success and failure now. So now we have to do the next part to complete this. So the next part to complete this is if you go and bring up @cedit on your machine.
Which one?
@cedit.
Oh.
Yeah. So does anyone know what @cedit does? So Ken, do you know what @cedit does? You have to unmute yourself. What about?
Hello.
Okay, yeah, no problem. So what about Joseph? Do you know what @cedit does? You're muted, Joseph, in case you want to speak. You have to unmute yourself. Okay, can add Joseph. So, yeah, there we go. Let's use this other server. Okay. So yeah, okay. So you're on. Yeah, okay. So you've connected to the default naming context, right?
Yes.
Okay. So this is an interesting one. So go back to so let's go back to your machine. So you've connected to default naming context. So can you see DNS there at all? No.
No.
No, not at all. So what about if you expand system? Expand
System
system. Yep, expand system there.
doesn't expand. Oh, my, I guess
Yeah.
it does.
So let's see. DNS
DFS.
config. So there's no DNS there, right?
No.
No. Okay. So one thing that you probably want to check out on your machine is the way you've configured your DNS, because it depends on the way you've configured it. That's going to determine where
I
the
don't believe I've configured it at all.
Okay. So one thing you want to do is okay. If you go back to @cedit, if you right click @cedit at the top.
Here.
Where @cedit itself, so the word @cedit at the very top, yeah, and then connect to. So in the case, so your what's your domain controller name? What do you call
DC1.
this? Is, I'm sorry, what's your domain name?
Oh, wallyworld.com.
Okay, yeah. So what you want to do is you want to specify where to connect to. So instead of selecting a well-known naming context, if you s select or type.
Select
Yeah,
right here.
exactly. And then if you type it, can you type there? Yeah.
Yep.
So if you type DC, DC,
DC.
yeah, equals to domain DNS zone.
Like that.
Yeah, then comma, then DC equals to your other domain. So Wally World, DC equals to com, you know, the full,
Oh, like
yeah,
this,
the distinguished name, yeah.
and then I need the com.com
Yeah,
at the end?
so that would be DC equals to com
Like
also. Yeah, so
that?
yes. Well, you need to remove the DC1. So you don't need the DC1, you just need your domain. Yeah. Yeah, and then if you try to connect to that. So that's not the. Yeah, let's bring this one up. Let's go.
You know, like I said, I don't think I have DNS set up at all in there.
Okay. So can you see my screen, guys? You can see my screen.
Yep.
Yeah, okay. So let's make this full screen. So just to reinforce the ones that we already showed. So again, let's check. Is audit is the auditing enabled on this machine at all? So let's go. So that will show me if auditing is enabled at all. And I can see it's not enabled. So it's enabled for directory service access, but not for changes. So again, we'll talk about this when you start seeing it. So DNS record deletion is a change. So what we need to do is we need to go to group policy. So in this environment, there are two domain controllers. So we need to go to group policy and enable that for our two domain controllers. So for the one for hard CID, we've asked the question, do we know what hard CID does? So Active Directory itself is a database. So what does a database do? A database stores information. That's all it does. So a database stores information. Active Directory itself is a database. But now you can view the database using different tools. Like you see, you use Active Directory users and computers, right? So when we use Active Directory users and computers, what we're seeing is we're seeing a part of the database, but we're not seeing the full database. So one of the ways to actually view the Active Directory database, so there are different tools you can use. One of the tools you can use is the tool called AdCEdit. So you can use that to connect to different parts of Active Directory database and see what's going on. And that's for like a different topic, because Active Directory, again, it's a database. It has different partitions. So there is a partition, something called a domain partition, which is the one that you connected to earlier, Frank. Then there's a partition called the schema partition. So schema partition, you've heard people talk about, oh, no problem, Joseph. You've heard people talk about, oh, Active Directory schema. And all it's just talking is, it's just something that describes the object that you can have in Active Directory. So if you actually view the schema, so I know this is not what we're discussing today, but if I go at edit.msc, if you actually view the schema, you'll see something like, if I go here, at edit here, and I go connect to, when instead of connecting to the default naming context, I want to connect to the schema here, and I go okay. So what will I see in the schema? So the schema, if I expand it, will show me and say, you see two different classes. So there's one called a class schema, there's one called an attribute schema. So the class schema is what determines the kind of object you can have. For example, if I keep scrolling down, I will see a class schema here called user. So if I go down, 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 and you see it's, let's scroll all the way down to stu, and here we go, here's a class schema here called user. So this is the actual part of database that describes the object called the user. So this schema object would describe, oh, you can have an object called user, and this object can have a name, this object can have an email address. So the thing that defines that is stored right here in the schema. So you can view that using AdCEdit. You can view the default naming context, which can show you some of the objects that are stored in Active Directory. So that's like what you can use this one for. So the one that I was talking about in connecting to DNS and to see what's going on, is if I go here and I go connect to, instead of doing that, I can say I want to connect to and this particular one. If I go DC equals to DNS domain zones, DC equals to lightbulb IT, DC equals to CO, DC equals to UK. DNS. So could be that it's different. DC equals to DNS domain zones. Oh, 1 minute. Oh, okay, sorry, wrong one, my bad, sorry. It's not DNS domain zone, it's domain DNS zones. Sorry, my bad. Now, okay. Domain DNS zones. com IT.
That works.
Yo, okay, domain DNS zones works for you, right?
Yeah.
Yep. So, okay, one thing I can also try. So let me go, because it depends on how I've configured this one. So let me try that one. No. So it's got to be... domain DNS zones. No. Domain DNS zones. Light bulb IT. This is you. No, that's all right. Oh, okay. No, not this one. Not this one. It's definitely... So again, it connects to... So, this equals to... Domain DNS... Zones... This equals to... Test... Oh, sorry, not test. Light bulb IT. This E equals to CO. This E equals to UK. Not domain DNS zones, and it's not forest. It's not even got. Let's see my DNS configuration. This will guide us to know what we're looking for. I go to my DNS configuration. So the thing that matters is where have I decided to store this. So we go lightbulb IT. So that's Active Directory integrated. Yeah, so that's the main DNS zone. Let's bring this one up again. Okay, yeah, I'll come back to this one. But in the meantime, let's go back to the policy one. So expand domain controller. I'll just edit the default domain controller policy. I want to create a new one. What I want is under this one. I go under Windows settings, under security settings. Under local policies, under audit policy, audit directory service access. I enable that. And then if I force an update now. Yep, and then okay, so if I do the audit poll again, now we can see that directory service changes has been enabled. So now the next part is this one that I need to do. So I need to change this one. So it's definitely So because this is where we have to do the second part of enabling auditing. Light bulb IT. This is supposed to see you. Oh, look at me. Yeah. Did anybody see the mistake I made? That was a silly mistake. Anybody see the mistake? So I had a dash here instead of equals to. That will explain why it's not working. Yeah, so that'll work now. So for people wondering what's going on. So what's going on is this. So again, remember that Active Directory is just a database and there are different parts of that database. So for example, because my DNS, if I go back to DNS, if you look at the configuration, I've set this as an Active Directory integrated zone. So what this means is that this DNS zone will be stored in the Active Directory database. And depending on what I've configured to this, look at the replication. I'm saying, oh, this replication will occur to all DNS servers in this zone. Because of that configuration, the DNS database itself is going to be stored in this part of the Active Directory database. Let's say if I were to change this, let's demonstrate that. So let's go OK now. Okay, still not working. What have I done wrong here? This equals this equals to light bulb IT. This equals to CO. This equals to UK. I done something wrong there. Let's remove. I'm almost sure that I got that one correct. So select this one. This equals to UK. So is that the exact same thing that you did? That's the exact thing that you have, right? You have domain DNS zones, right?
Yeah, I just typed in what you told me to.
Yeah, and then this equals to this. Yeah, so that should definitely work. So let's go LB DC 2. Let's see if that makes any difference. No, not sure. Can't see anything wrong with this, with what I've typed. Can't see absolutely nothing wrong with it. Joseph did it. I just did it and it worked. Exactly. I'm not okay. You know what? I'll just bounce this server. So let's bounce this server. I'll bounce the other one too, because these machines have been on for like a long time. They've just been saved, not been restarted at all. So let's just bounce them. Connect. And this one is a server core machine. So come on. I'll go So that one should be coming back up now. So waiting that start computer. Let me start this one too. And then we'll try to connect to it again. And then we'll connect to both of them again when they're ready. Okay. So why they're both doing that? So again, we enable this on the we enable this here. So Frank, let's go through yours. So you've connected to ArtsEdit, you've connected to that, right?
So yeah.
So let's go through the steps on yours then. So rather than wait for this one. So yeah, so after yeah, exactly. So expand that. So now you can see your zones here. So you for any zone that you want to audit, you have to enable auditing per zone also. So if you right click, for example, yeah, if you right click that one and then go under properties and then go under security, good. Yeah, so what you want to do is go under advanced, because again, what you're seeing here is just in security for access, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what, yeah, so you have to go under advanced and then you go under the auditing tab. So again, now we've enabled that on the server level, and now we want to enable this on the zone level. So now you can see there's already some editing entries for everyone for success. Mm-hmm. But in this case, if you had another one, so had another entry there under auditing, and in this case, select a principal. So it depends. Do you want to edit only a group of people? Most organizations will just go for want to edit everyone, you know. Join to the domain or not, anybody that, you know, any attempt to update a DNS record or update anything in Active Directory, we want to know about it. So if you type in everyone again there, yep, and then okay. And then basically you select, what do you want? Do you just want success? Do you want success and failure? So under type there at the top.
Both, right?
Yes. So it depends. So do you want all? Or that. So then the other thing which is also important is when it says permissions there, it's confusing, right? Because it looks as if, are we talking about permissions? So what you're saying is, what do you want to audit? So that's what permissions mean. Do you want to audit everything, which is full control? Do you want to audit only when things are deleted, when things are read, when things are modified? What exactly do you want to audit in this case? So that's what you are, that's what we'll have to select in this case under auditing. So in this case, let's just go for okay, if anything is written, so let's go for write all properties. So we want that. So we also want delete. So if anything is deleted, we can go for delete subtree also. If anything is deleted on in subtree, yeah. So and this one at least will give us like basic information on if anything is deleted, if anything is updated, if anything is accessed. So you can click OK to that. And then click OK to that also. Yep. And then OK. And now we basically have auditing enabled. So here's an interesting one to demonstrate this. So create a temporary record. Create a record in on your DNS. So just go to bring up the DNS console. You don't need to do it from here. So we'll come back to this one. Leave that one open. We'll come back to that. Because that other also helps us a lot. So again, yeah. So create a DNS record here. Just something temporarily. Give it any IP address that you want. We'll delete it anyway. So what we want to see is, let's modify a record. Let's delete a record. Let's see where can we trace that. So create one.
Oh, you're going to have to walk me through it.
Okay. Does anyone want to walk? So, Ken, do you want to walk? Do you want to walk Frank to it? Or does anyone want to walk Frank to it? Anyone? Nicholas, you want to walk Frank to it? To how to create a DNS record?
Yeah,
You have to carry on.
Isn't it just new host and then you enter whatever address and then record name?
Yeah, exactly.
So test. Then if you have a specific IP.
Yep. So just give it any IP. You don't really need an IP that's valid because this is for demonstration. So we want to create two. So create two record. We'll modify one, we'll delete one. So create another one. So while you're doing that, I'll just check my computer. So have you created the two now?
I did.
Ah, nice. Okay. So here's the demonstration. So we just want one. So just let's take... So you've created them now. So open Event Viewer on your machine. So just bring up Event Viewer and then go under the security log. So the two records that you just created now, let's see if we can see that here. So just keep scrolling down, just keep going down one by one. So from the very top, we're seeing some things there. So just keep going down, directory service access, yeah, keep going down one by one. And then you see an operation was performed. So if you double click on them to open them to make them larger so we can read the full message. So an operation was performed on an object. If you scroll down, what object was the operation performed on? Let us see. Scroll down.
Service DNS zones.
Yeah, it says DNS zone. Keep scrolling down. It will give us good information. Object access. So this is telling you like when you accessed an object. So this is not what we want. So you can click the down arrow button down there on the right hand side to go to the next record. So that's read property. So that's when you're reading something. Okay. So keep going down. Keep going down.
Right here? Scroll down or next?
No, I'm going to the next one. Yeah.
Next record?
Yeah, next event. Read, keep going. So what's the name of the record that you created?
Test machine.
Test machine. Okay, keep going down.
Well, maybe we got to start up here.
So, yeah, keep going down. So again, remember that because we've enabled read in our auditing also. So anytime anybody opens DNS record to read anything, it's gonna log something. So keep going down. My guess would be it's way down there, because these things will be very noisy. So just get ready for that. If you're gonna enable this, they are noisy, but then they can save you. Keep going down. Yep. Keep going down. You probably have to go down a bit much more to. Keep going down. Okay, if we don't get this one, in order not to waste time, what we can do is let's look at the latest record. What's the time for the latest
record?
So if we can't find that one easily, so yeah, that's all right. So that's all right. So just refresh the screen. So just refresh it. Yeah. So what's the last record? What's the time there? 12:14:37, right?
Yep.
So, yeah. Yeah. There are new entries now. So refresh it again. Yeah, so 12:14:43. So just go and delete one of the records now.
In
DNS. So if you go to, so just one of them, just delete one of them. Delete, yep, and yes. Okay, so let's go back to the event log. And then if we refresh it, and then let's open them and start scrolling down. And then we'll see what happened. Now look at that. That's interesting, right? So now one thing that we've noticed, that's the record that you just deleted. Object name is the name of the record you deleted. Access type. Now notice, remember that we mentioned that DNS deletion is a change. And we'll explain the reason why it's a change. So let's actually just explain the reason why it's a change. So if you look at my screen, let's explain the reason why DNS record is a DNS deletion is a change. So in DNS, right? So this is your domain controller that has your DNS server. You have your DNS pane here. You have Active Directory here. So because these DNS records, because they are Active Directory integrated, so they are actually Active Directory objects. So you have a record here for test machine. So the record that you're seeing here for test machine that you deleted now, that record, as far as Active Directory is concerned, is actually an Active Directory object. So when you right click it here and you go delete, what Active Directory just does is it changes a property. So it just changes the property of this object to delete, which is why when you look at it, what you're going to see is you will see a write rather than a deletion. So let's see that. So if you go back to add cedit, so again, remember that now you've seen your, before you close that completely, let's go back to that event again, because let's see if we can see who deleted it from there. So if you scroll down, keep scrolling down, can we see who there? Did they mention any name? So if you scroll, if you go up, so yeah, you can see security ID tells you exactly who deleted the record. So security ID at the top, right? That's the account that you're logged in as, right?
Yes.
So that tells you who deleted the record, exactly when the record was deleted. But again, remember that when you're looking through this, don't be looking for a deletion activity. It's going to be a write property, right? Okay, so if you go back to add cedit, let's see why is it showing as a write property rather than a deletion. So if you refresh that.
Add cedit?
Yeah, I'm sorry, if you refresh the zone, the DNS zone that you are on, just right click and refresh on it. And then expand DNS. Yeah, and then expand the Microsoft DNS, expand your zone. So you can see test machine that you deleted is still here, right?
Yes.
You know, but hold on, I thought we deleted it, right? I thought it's already deleted. Yeah, you deleted it in DNS, but it still exists in Active Directory. But if you double click on it to open it, and then under the attributes, if you scroll down and look for the attribute that says is deleted. So scroll down. Yeah. So what does that attribute say?
Is not set or not set.
So you need, I think, so is that the record that you deleted?
Yeah, that is. Maybe so, I didn't refresh this.
Yeah, so you need to refresh that. Yeah, exactly. So refresh that. So is that the one that you definitely deleted though?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it still says not set.
because that should now be set to true.
Right, if we go back over here, it's test machine 222 still here, the other one's gone.
So if you go back to that one and then refresh that again. So right click on the record itself. Is there any refresh there? No. Refresh on the record itself.
Refresh this. Oh, it has a property sheet up?
Yeah.
Hang on.
You may need to do Alt Tab to bring it up. I'll just double click on the record again. It will bring the property sheet up. So double click on the same record, yeah. And then, so if you cancel that.
Yeah.
So if you cancel that.
Yeah.
And then refresh the zone again. Refresh that zone again, yeah. So one thing, so how many domain controllers do you have on your lab environment? So one or two?
Just this one.
Just this one, okay. So again, if you go to the test machine record again, if you double click on it, so double click on that, and if you filter, actually if you go to filter and go to, oh okay, yeah, sorry, my bad, sorry, my, yeah, that's my bad. So if you go to, so is deleted is set to not set, so that's okay. So the thing that actually changes is that property called DNS tombstone at the top. That one. Set
okay.
to true. So if you go back to, if you cancel that, and if you double click the one for the other one you've not deleted, and then you go to DNS tombstone, what does it say?
Not set.
Not set. So if you now go back and delete it, then refresh this one. So go back to delete the other one.
You want to delete
DNS,
this one?
Yep, delete that one and then refresh that. So the reason why we're doing this, you see, I know it doesn't all come together now, but you see the reason why we're doing all this. So just refresh that zone. And then if you go to view that record, you see that DNS tombstone is now set to true.
Yeah.
Right? DNS tombstone is now set to true. So yeah, it's like, so somebody says, how does that help me? So if somebody comes into your office and says, 15 DNS records have just, important DNS records have just been deleted, find out what went wrong. You're like, hold on, does that mean I have to be looking through, you know, a million events, trying to figure out which one says right property, trying to figure out which one? No. So here's where you go from it. If you want to troubleshoot that, easy. First thing, start from add C edit. Because the record may have been deleted, but it's still going to exist on the domain by default for 7 days. So this record will be here for the next 7 days. It will still exist with tombstone set to true. After 7 days, then it's going to be deleted. So you see, so the is deleted will now be set to true. In which case, that's another topic, because then it goes through Active Directory tombstone process. But in this case, you get the point. The point is, this record will remain in at, you'll be able to view it from etcedit for the next 7 days. Tombstone equals to true. So how does that help me to troubleshoot it? I'll start in etcedit, look for the record. Then I'll look for the date that this record was modified. The date that the record was modified is the date that the record was deleted. So if you do a filter, just filter only objects. So if you do a filter for only attributes that have values. Yeah. Then look for the one that talks about date modified. One of the attributes that talks about a date that was modified. So you may have to scroll down to find that. Yeah, when changed. So once you find the time that it was changed, that's the time that I will go to look. So look at the exact time that that happened. That exact time, now go look in event viewer and see whether you will not see that record there. So for the exact time and the exact second. So it's going to be exact with the exact second. So at the edit. So bring that up. Yeah.
12/21/01.
Nice. So look for 12/21/01 there. So there may be lots of records for 12/21/01, but one of those records is for this deletion. So just keep going till you find 12/21/01. Yeah, so start from the first one and keep going down and see. So can you see, is that the one that tells you about the deletion? Yes, because you can see right property, the record that was deleted, and exactly who made the modification. So again, you see how all this works together now, right?
Now, so if somebody creates one, though, is it going to still be write? Or is it going to say access will be created?
So I'm not sure. So we may need to test that. So, but the thing is, I'm not sure if we are currently auditing creation. If we go back to the auditing that we enabled for the zone, so the one that we enabled for Active Directory is okay. So you remember that where we were selecting exactly what we wanted to audit. So you need to look for the zone in etcedit, then go under properties of the zone, and then go under security. And then go under security, and then advanced, good, excellent, and then auditing, and then yep, you can hide it or you can edit that. Yeah, you can select that and edit that and then see which one. What did we? So we said read, write, delete. Is there anything that says create there?
This create child objects and DNS node objects.
Yeah, So yeah, so if we've enabled it, so again, while you if you're like, oh, I'm not sure exactly which one to enable, you could enable just full control, which will tick everything, but then you must be ready because your logs should be full of all kinds of stuff. So what that means is this: if somebody opens etc edit on a different computer connected to your domain, you're gonna see hundreds of logs. Because every time they open etc edit, it's reading all those records. So you're gonna see all those records read, and your logs are gonna be full of all kinds of stuff. So if you want to enable that, just get ready for that. So but I will say for now, just select maybe create all child objects and then test to create one and then see what it logs. So that's like the kind of way that we play with stuff to figure out how exactly these things work. So go ahead and create another object. But so Ken and Nicola, so if I come to you and I say, can you troubleshoot 15 records that went missing? Do you know how to troubleshoot that now? Or do you have any questions with that? So you know exactly where to start from. Start from etc/edit. The record will still be there in the next 7 days, right? The record will only have the DNS tombstone set to true. So look for the record. Look for when it was modified, right? Go look in the event log for the exact time and exact second that it was modified. You'll find who made that modification there.
I
But
appreciate the recap. You did lose me there for a second. I got a little confused.
okay, yeah. What which one confused you? So we can go over that.
No, I was just like sort of confused about the overall process. I your screen's really small, so I can't really
Yeah,
see
that's
you
true. So, okay, we've gone through that on Frank's machine, so I think my own machine is up now. So actually, let's see if we can quickly. So I go PA. And this one actually help us because Frank has only one domain controller, right? So here's the interesting bit. You know what the interesting bit is, Frank? So we've talked about how you troubleshoot that, right? So here's the interesting bit that most organizations don't have one domain controller in their environment, right? You have one, some have, four, five different domain controllers. And here's the thing is that you can make DNS changes on any of these domain controllers. Okay? You go on this machine. So here's where the situation comes. So this is a domain controller. These are all different types of domain controllers. So someone comes on this machine and makes a DNS change or deletes a DNS record. Deletes record TTT. So record TTT is deleted. And what will happen with Active Directory replication, right, is going to replicate that deletion all over. Now, Frank comes and Frank logs into this domain controller here. And Frank goes to etc/edit. And etc/edit says, oh, record TTT was changed at 111. So you're like, okay, that was exactly when this record was deleted on this domain controller, 111. Because I opened etc/edit on this domain controller, it tells me this record was modified on this date, okay? So then you go to Event Viewer, and Event Viewer will tell you, instead of seeing who made the modification, you know what you're gonna see? You're gonna see event like DC replication event. And you're like, okay, hold on, I'm just seeing DC replication event. There's no way for me to tell who or what made this modification or who or what made this deletion. Then you go to this next one, and this next one, you're gonna see a similar event at a different time because the deletion did not happen on this domain controller. It happened on this one and got replicated out to this one. So in a situation where you have multiple domain controllers, how do you do that? How do you find out which of these domain controllers did this record get deleted from? Right? It's a good question, right? How do you find out which one? Any suggestions from anyone? Nicholas, let's start with you. Any suggestion? How do I find out which of these domain controllers this record got deleted from? Or do you just want us to find out directly so we don't? Oh, Ken, okay. Any ideas, Ken? Any ideas?
No, I don't have any ideas.
All about fun. Any ideas?
Well, if you know how many system admins you got and where they sit, then you can find out what domain controller they logged into naturally, and then you can look at the logs.
So,
there.
Do you think an admin that maybe made a mistake did the record would go, yeah, Frank, that's me.
No, I but deleted the record just for. Me if I could figure it out,
I deleted the record for a mail server. or let's say it's not even, because in most situations with DNS, you find out that the culprits are not actually users or your admins. The culprits are actually machines. Actually, you can trace it back to the admin, maybe due to misconfiguration. Because one that I had to do recently was a misconfiguration or an issue. Actually, it was a bug with machines and machines deleting their own records. But it was scary, right? Because all of a sudden we came in and all these records were missing. So the first thing you have to do is, okay, before we do anything, we need to find out what's the source of this deletion. Right? So we need to find the source to know nothing serious is going on. Otherwise, we come in one morning, the mail servers are all gone from DNS. Let's find out what is the source of this deletion. And when we follow this whole process that I just talked you through, we found that it was the clients themselves. They were deleting their own records from DNS. So we're like, at least we know there's nothing crazy like scavenging going on, deleting all kinds of records. We know that this is something to do with this client. And that was a bug that Microsoft had an hot fix for that fixes that. So in case you've seen that in your environment, you may want to look on Microsoft's website for an hot fix for Windows 7 Server 2008 out to computers deleting their own records in DNS. So DC Lightbulb IT, DC equals to CO, DC equals to UK. Please work this time. Hey, again, I'm not sure. Just doesn't like. Or actually, maybe I need to forest. Maybe I'm just not. Let's go back to this one. Let's go back to the default naming context. On the system, it's the Microsoft DNS. Yeah. So okay. No, but this doesn't contain my zone. My zone is stored in Active Directory database somewhere for sure. Which zone is it stored in? Which zone? It's supposed to be that. I'm not sure. So this is what's stopping me from being able to demonstrate this, guys. Is that this is not allowing me to. I can, if I go DC equals to domain DNS zones. Oh, okay. I hope I've not been making this miserable. So that's domain missing an A. Domain DNS zones. Domain DNS zones. The light bulb it.co.uk. Yeah, I think I'll just cap a demo for my servers just not functioning well today. Sorry. I know exactly. Oh, sorry, my bad. Cause, I'm typing in the wrong thing. I missed internal. I'm just tired. Sorry. So if I go, DC equals to internal. Yeah, my bad. Yeah, there we go. Sorry for wasting your time. And then let's expand Microsoft DNS here, and then you can see my zone here. And basically what we've said is, okay, my zone here is internal.lightbulbit.co.uk, and there's like loads of records here. So I've enabled auditing in group policy. Now I have to enable it for this zone. So I can go under properties, under security. Now if I go under HAD, this is talking about permissions. I have to go under advanced and go under the auditing tab. And then I have to enable auditing here. So if I, what do I want to audit? Do I want to audit particular group? Usually many people go for, I want to audit everyone. No, I want to know, I don't care whoever makes changes or whatever makes changes, I want to audit anyone. If you want to audit just if there's any success, if it's successful or if it fails, I want to audit all whether success or failures. Then read, delete, create child objects. 1 minute, guys, I'll just go get my, open the door for my wife. 1 minute, I'll be back in a minute. Hello, yeah, sorry about that. Okay, yeah, so if I go ahead and select delete, so if people modify the permission, maybe I want to find out, but I'll just leave this one for now. And I go, okay, and apply that, okay. And the thing that we did was, if I go back here, I can go under event viewer here. I can go under event viewer there. And under my security log is where I'm going to see any changes. So just to do the same demonstration that we already did before, I go under DNS. And I go under my zone here. And I create a record, same record that Frank created earlier. So I create a new host name, call it test machine one. Give it an IP address of 1.1.1.1. Add it, create another one called test machine 2, give it an IP of 2.2.2.2. So done. So let me go look in the event, in the event viewer now. Refresh this F5. And so for Frank, that was Frank was asking, so what does it log if I create a record?
It didn't log
anything.
No, I checked. I looked back at the time. It doesn't show anything.
I can see mine here. It's logged a write.
Oh, it's still
so
right.
Yeah. So this one is 2002-2016 this time. Mm-hmm. And I can see a write here.
So yeah. You don't know if they're creating a log or deleting a log at that
so
point.
So one way to, one, the way to know is the record tombstoned?
So each, so if somebody, if the machine is creating them and deleting them just as quick, then you're going to have to look through all of the records there and see whether they're all tombstone.
Yeah. Or there's another option. There's a third option. So you're right.
I'm sure there's some, probably some PowerShell, right?
There's some PowerShell part to this, not for that, but there's another option that we'll talk about. So for example, now the one that we talked about now, we can see, you know, the mesh, we can see the user, the access type, whether read or write, and what happened. But we'll get to that one, Frank, in a minute. We'll get to that one, the other option. So let's, if I refresh this one, let's see the two records that I created, test machine one and test machine two. So I'll refresh this one. Where's test machine? Yeah, so here we have test machine one and test machine two. So I can go here and I can go, when created, I can see the date that it was created. So that's 20/37/46. I can go look at this time in the event viewer and I'll see the record. So 20/37/36 is it? 20/37/46. So 20/37/46, and I will see the record of when this was created. Where is that? 46. There we go. This one and this one. And there we go. So that's the record for this machine when it was created. by whom it was created and the type. So it's a byte, right? So if I go and do and delete this object now, or sorry, delete this record, which is test machine one, I go, I right click on it and I click delete. So what we've said is if I delete it, now it's gone from what I can see in DNS, but this object is not gone in Active Directory, still exists in Active Directory, which is why if I go under etcedit here and I refresh this, I'll still see, okay, I have this open, so cancel this. If I refresh this, I'll still see this object here, even though I've deleted it in DNS. Because again, it's going to exist here by default for 7 days. The only thing that's happened is it modified this property and set this to DNS tombstone equals to true. And I can scroll down like what we said, and I can see when this record was changed. So that's 20:40:36. And this will tell me the exact time that this record was deleted. So 20:40:36, I go back here and I refresh. 20:40:36. Let's keep scrolling down. 20:40:36, he said. Oh, is it 36? 20:40. Yep, it's 20:40:36. So let's go to till we get to 20:40:36. Where are we? 20:40:36. That's a lot of scrolling down. We'll get there eventually.
Filter by the date.
Yeah, that's true. So filter current. Can we filter by the exact time? So log custom range first event. Yeah, that's true. Let's just go first event. Oh no, sorry, event on today 20:40. Let's go 35 to 37. 20:40:37 and go okay and okay to that. Yep, and 20:40:36 will see exactly on this record, will tell me when this record was deleted, and that will be a write. Yeah, and that's it there. So that's a write that happened, initiated by this guy here, and what they did was that was when deletion happened. So to answer Frank's question of, so what if the thing was getting created, deleted, multiple? Is there a way for us to do that? There's another level of logging you can do in DNS apart from this. So what this one can help you is if you're doing like troubleshooting and you want to track where sources of changes are coming from. But you could also go under DNS properties here. Is it under DNS properties here? Under the DNS server in this case, go under properties and go under debug login. And enable debug login. So it's going to tell you what do you want to log. You want to log queries, updates, whatever. You can log this one, and you can
pick that for this. Where'd you pick that out of?
So that's the property of the server, of the DNS server. So I can go under properties here, and I can enable this. Yeah, and I can go under properties here, and log packet for debugging there. And then I can go, you know, you can do as much debug logging as you want. Specify where you want to log this. So I can go C, Windows, System32, DNS.log. And go specify the size that you want it to be. So once it gets filled up, it's going to roll the log over. So specify the logs that you want. So if you're going to be leaving this overnight and you're going to be enabling all these, if you're in a very busy environment, you probably want to make this like really big, because otherwise you come in the morning and it's rolled over the log and you can't see what happened through the night. So if I click apply to that and go okay, and if I go open the log itself, so if I go to C drive, Windows, System32, and if I go to dns.log, is the name that I gave to it. Now, because on this machine I have Configuration Manager, it's going to try to use cmtrace to open it. which isn't probably what I want. So I'll probably close this one. I'll just use Notepad to open it. Open with Notepad, yeah. Okay. And then you can see what the log looks like. And this is like really crazy because, again, every query. So a machine queries this mesh, this server for a DNS record. It's going to log it. It's going to log the type of query, the service record, if it's a start of authority record, from which machine. And you can see to understand what the, to understand the interpretation of this log, just look to the top here. So for example, I can see how is for response. Very soon, 15 minutes time. Yeah. So I can see.
Hello,
my it's my wife. Sorry. okay. So we got okay. So authoritative answer. So you can see. Interpret what this log means from here. So for example, the queue here is talking about here's a standard query that was received from this address querying for this SRV record, and you can see all that here. And this is this one will be very, very useful to you, like in the case of the one I talked about where the client was deleting their own record. So you could use this in conjunction with the rtedit. So look at when the record was modified. Look at the IP address that that came from, that the request came from. So in that case, you see a request. For example, let me do something. So let's close this one. So let me update a record. So let me go to a DNS record here. Under this zone, and let me update a record. Let me update a record that's not too important to me. Let me update test 003. So I'll change it from 202. I'll change that to 209 and go apply and go OK. So I've modified that. So then if I go back to open the DNS log, open with Notepad, and if I scroll down. So one that I'm looking for is one that will say, okay. Here's an interesting, here's one that you should make note of. So this one will help you. So, you know, the one that we've been talking about with @edit, right? And the method we've been talking about, you can act using @edit to trace it back to the event log. That method is mostly useful for deletion that happened on the machine. Now this particular one that I've just enabled is only useful for you for things that are happening over the network. So for example, like the situation that I mentioned where machines were deleting their own records, that'll be here. But now I've updated the record, I can't find that on this log here. So but let's say a machine were to send an update packet to this DNS server and says update this DNS record, I'll find that here. It will tell me the IP address it came from. It will tell me that it's an update that was sent by this machine for this record. So I'm not sure if that help at all. Do you understand DNS troubleshooting much more than before?
Yeah.
Well, how about you, Ken? Do you understand it much more than before?
Yes.
Yeah.
This is, I never knew about most of
this. So yeah. So the thing is, what about Nicholas? So yes, the thing is that it may not like all be clear at once, but again, like at least you have an awareness of things to do, right? So eventually, when something comes up later, like that you have to troubleshoot something in DNS, you at least have an awareness of where to start, right? So even though you may not like fully understand all what's going on, you at least have an awareness of what's going on and different things that you can do. So that's like, I mean, if you get just that awareness, I think that's sufficient. Eventually, things will come up where you need to use these, then things will become clearer. The more you dig deep into it, the more it becomes clearer. But at least you have an awareness. If somebody says, hey, can we find out, if this record gets deleted, are we able to trace it? You can give them a clear answer. By default, no. So if you want us to be able to trace it in our environment, you know, you have to, something you have to discuss with your security team or whatever. If you want us to be able to trace it, we have to enable login. On the group policy level, we have to enable login, and we have to enable login for the zone. So it's not something that happens by default. So if you come into the office one day and you've not enabled all this login that we talked about, and all your DNS records are gone, you won't be able to find out what's gone on. You won't be able to find out. You're just like, yep, I can't, you know, restore from backup, whatever. So it's not something that's enabled by default. It's something that you have to, number one, enable it in group policy. Number two, enable it for the zone. If you now want more debugging for requests across the network, number three, enable DNS login, DNS debug login on DNS server. So let me just quickly end with one of the favorite topics of most people, or the topic that most people avoid or don't understand, which is DNS scavenging. So we'll end with that. We have only 10 more minutes to go. So DNS scavenging. I know a lot of people are scared of this topic because people don't understand, like, you know, DNS scavenging is basically you're cleaning up DNS. So records that are old, that are stale, that no one has updated the record for a long time, you are cleaning them up from DNS. But how does that work? You know, how do you interpret scavenging? That's like the part that stumps many people. So for example, let's go here. If I right click this server here and I go to set aging and scavenging for all zones, right? Okay, I click on that. Oh, I see this option. Number one, I can enable scavenging by doing that. Number two, I see these two strange settings. No refresh interval and refresh interval. No refresh interval. The time between the most recent refresh of a record timestamp and the moment when the timestamp may be refreshed. You're like, hold on, I have no clue what that's talking about. Right? Then you're like, refresh interval, the time between the earliest moment when a record timestamp can be refreshed and the earliest moment when a record can be scavenged. You're like, just tell me in plain English, what am I configuring? What exactly are these records doing? We'll do that now in plain English, yeah? So what happens is whenever there's a DNS record, so let's put it this way, first of all, to begin with. DNS scavenging by default only works with dynamic updates. So that's an important thing. That's the very first thing you have to know. It only works with dynamic updates. What does that mean? What that means is if I go to this DNS server, right? If I cancel out of this, and I create a static record like I've done in the case of test machine 2, DNS scavenging will never, ever, ever by default remove this record. No matter if it doesn't change for the next 50 years, if this server is up for the next 50 years, DNS scavenging will never remove it. The only records that DNS scavenging will remove are records that have been updated or added dynamically. What do we mean by records that have been updated or added dynamically? You have a client on your network. You have a DNS server. You have a DHCP server. So you have DHCP here. You have DNS here. This client comes on the network. Of course, they are all connected by a switch, whatever switch, Netgear, Cisco, Brocade, anything. So we have the client here. So this client comes on the network. Of course, first thing is, hey, I need an IP address to be able to communicate with anything on this network. So it's going to send a request to this DHCP server. Of course, this one too will respond back with an IP address and say, here's an IP address. If this client is a Windows machine, by default, this client will attempt to add its record to DNS. That is what is called dynamic update. So this client by default will be like, oh, now I have an IP address. I know my name and I just received an IP address. Therefore, I will send my name and my IP address to the DNS server to register a record. That's what's going to happen. Or if we've configured DHCP and set to DHCP, so we could configure DHCP and say, any client that you give out IP address to, create a record for them. Once you release the IP address you give to them, remove the record. So in which case, this client requests an IP from DHCP. DHCP is like, I'll give you an IP. Once the client confirms and says, I've accepted this IP, DHCP will say, I have your name, I have your IP, therefore I'll create a record for you. That is what we mean by dynamic updates. Those are the only record by default that DNS scavenging will affect. It will not affect static record. And you see the reason for that. So when this record is created, it has something called a timestamp. And the timestamp basically means exactly that. When the record was created. That's what it means. So going back to this one, you can see all this one that I've created statically, you can see static. If I double click on them, and actually, if I go under view and go under advanced here, you can see more. So I'll go under view on DNS, go under advanced here, you can see more information. And then if I double click on this, now I can see record timestamp is empty. So for this static record, scavenging will not affect it because scavenging uses timestamp to do what it does. But this record has no timestamp because it was statically created manually by somebody. So there's a way for me to enable scavenging for this record. That option. Delete this record when it becomes stale. But without that option, by default, scavenging will not do anything, will not affect the static record. But here's the thing. These other ones that have been dynamically added by the clients themselves or by DHCP server themselves, those are the ones, you see that by default, this is ticked. Scavenging will apply to this by default. And what happens is a record is created, it has a timestamp. That's when I'm created, okay? So what will happen is every now and then, depending if there are different situation, this client will attempt to update this timestamp on the DNS server. For example, this is a Windows client. You shut it down, it comes back up. One of the things it does when it comes back up is, hello DNS server, my name is still client one, my IP address is still 1.1.1.1. But hold on, nothing has changed in the record. But this client will attempt to update the timestamp and say, hey, I'm still alive, I've updated my timestamp. So that's the concept of this timestamp. So where does this other two, where do they come into play? When we go to enable scavenging, because this is the part that confuses people. When we go to enable scavenging, we see these two strange options, no refresh interval and refresh interval, and we have all these weird explanations that doesn't make any sense. So what that means, no refresh interval and refresh interval? Here's the way to understand them. Here's the way that I've understood them. So let's go no refresh interval. And there's another one called refresh interval. Now, no refresh interval, this is what it means. By default, it's 7 days, right? This is what that means. And the way that I've learned to understand this is to understand their purpose or the reason for this configuration. No refresh interval means for this amount of days, I will not allow you to update this timestamp of this DNS record. Now, I know that's like, okay, hold on, that's strange. So what that means is the DNS server will not allow this client to update this timestamp within this number of days. You may be like, why? Why is that? Why will I not let you update this timestamp? Okay, think about this. This client comes online. Its IP address is 1.1.1.1. Its name is client 1. This record is in DNS. The time is 12 p.m. that this record was created. So this machine, every morning, it restarted, right? It restarted, the user restarts their machine every morning. Every time this machine comes online, it goes, oh, hello, my name is still client 1. My IP address is still 1.1.1.1. But here's my new timestamp. And once that change happens, what happens is this in the background, is that you have all these multiple domain controllers around the world. This record, because the timestamp has changed, this change has to be replicated to all of them. Now, imagine you have 500 clients restarting every morning in your environment. So think of the amount of replication traffic that you have to allow just to update a timestamp, right? So the only thing you're updating is a timestamp, and you have like 500 updates going on, bouncing around all the domain controllers because you're updating timestamp. So what DNS record will do is to minimize replication traffic, I will use this no refresh interval. In other words, during this period, I will not allow you to update only the timestamp. So that word is important, only the timestamp. If the client comes and says, oh, my IP address has now changed to 1.1.1.2, I will allow you to update that. But if your IP address is the same, your name is the same, but the only thing you're trying to update is the timestamp, within the next 7 days, I will not allow you to update just the timestamp. And the purpose of no refresh interval is to minimize replication traffic. So once you understand the purpose of those two configurations, you understand them. No refresh interval, its purpose is to minimize replication traffic. Why refresh interval? Its purpose is to make sure you have enough time to tell me that you are still alive. So within this time, I will not allow you. So this record was created at 12 p.m. on 1st of January 2016. I will not allow you to update the timestamp alone till 7/1/2016. You're not going to be able to update that timestamp. Now, if your record change, if your IP address changes, I will allow you to update that. But if I receive an update packet from you, and the only thing that has changed is the timestamp, I'm not going to update it, because otherwise I have to replicate to 20 domain controllers around the world, and I have to do that for 5,000 clients. So I'm not going to allow you to do that. So that's what no refresh interval stands for. Refresh interval, on the other hand, what it stands for is now you can refresh yourself. So after the 7th, I'm going to allow you to update just the timestamp if you want. So from between 7th and 14/1/2016, which is 7 days, I will allow you to update just the timestamp. So this client has enough chance within 7 days to let me know whether it is still alive or not. So scavenging uses both no refresh interval and refresh interval. So let's try to draw a diagram, and we'll conclude here today. So the diagram goes like this. Number one is the timestamp. Timestamp, that's the number one. Number two is the no refresh interval. And let's track this all the way out. Number three is the refresh interval. Number four is scavenging. So the record gets created, it has a timestamp. The time is counting, the time begins to count. For the next 7 days, if the client tries to update only the timestamp, I won't let it update it, because I don't want to be replicating timestamp traffic all over the world for very little purpose. So after that 7 days ends, refresh interval starts. In which case, I will allow you to update just the timestamp if you want to. I'm giving you 7 days opportunity to do this. So 7 days opportunities pass. If you've updated it, of course, we go back to the timestamp, right? We go back to square one. In which case, no refresh interval, 7 days. But if within this period, the client does not update its record, then scavenging starts. And by default, you can see, if we go back to this configuration, by default, you can see that will be after 14 days. So is scavenging clear to you, or do you have any questions? Because this is where we'll stop for today. Is it clear, or is it confusing now? Or is it clearer than it was before?
Clear.
Yeah. Yeah. What about Nicholas? Is he clever now? You understand what scavenging does, how it does, what it does?
I'm significantly less confused about tombstones and scavenging now.
Yeah.
I was kind of confused on that. Thanks for touching on that.
No problem. Yeah, because I've also struggled with it in the past. Like, you know, I mean, you read some of these explanations, right? This even makes you even more confused. The time between the most recent refresh of a record timestamp and the moment when the timestamp is refreshed again. But like, what are you talking about? Then you go down, like, the time between the earliest moment when the record timestamp can be refreshed and the earliest moment when the records can be scavenged. But then, actually, if you break it down, it becomes clear. Okay, the time between the most recent refresh of a record timestamp and the moment the timestamp may be refreshed again. In other words, between 7 days, I'm not going to let you refresh your timestamp. So you configure the moment that you want. So the time between the earliest moment when the record timestamp can be refreshed and the earliest moment when it can be scavenged. So in other words, I'm giving you this period after the no refresh interval to let me know you're still alive. Otherwise, after that, I can scavenge you and I'll get rid of you. I'll consider you a stale record. So, yeah, nice one. For this one, we didn't really go into deep dive that I really wanted to go into. So I'll probably, because all the knowledge that I've prepared with the deep dive are still inside me, so I'll probably schedule a part 3 special angle for DHCP DNS, because we need to see all these things on the Wireshark level, on the network level. What I was going to talk about today, assuming DNS 3 work, was actually demonstrate secure and insecure DNS updates, and also demonstrate the new DHCP failover feature, what communication goes between the two DHCP servers, what are the different states, how to recognize the different states. So at least we have a deep understanding of what's going on with this. But we didn't even touch close to that today. So that means we'll have a part 3 some point in the future. Okay, thanks very much, guys. And then we'll see again next time. I think we'll do an SCCM hangout this weekend. Maybe Saturday or Sunday. I'll send the invite. Yeah, I got my... There we go. 1 minute. So we'll do the SCCM hangout. Is that this Saturday or this Sunday? And then I will be doing more and more hangout. I'm like, yeah, there's lots and lots and lots for us to learn and revise and do all kinds of stuff.
Are we gonna do PowerShell again?
PowerShell is probably on hold for now, but you know what? I'm doing the advanced PowerShell training at the end of March. So I think after I finish that training, I think I'll even more enthusiastic about PowerShell. So, and by the way, I didn't answer the question. That reminded me, but maybe that we leave that for next time. I didn't answer the question of, if you have multiple domain controllers, how do you detect which one the record got deleted from? So the way to do that is a little PowerShell code that basically says, go into etcedit on all these domain controller, get me the time that this record was modified. Then look for the one that happened first, and then you know the DNS server where the record got deleted from. So it's just like a 3-line code of, for each domain controller, go into etcedit, get the modified date for this record. And then it's going to list all that for you, and you're like, yep, it was modified on this one at 1 p.m., modified on this one at 12 a.m., modified on this one at 10 a.m. Oh, I know the deletion happened at the one on 10 a.m., then was replicated to the other ones from there. So then you like, that's the event log that I'm going to go look at, the one of this server.
Can you post that for us?
Yeah, I can post that. I think I'll post that.
Yeah,
I'll
put that on the room.
I'll post that on the community. Okay, yeah, guys. So see you next time. Have a wonderful time.
Right. Take care.
I got to go have dinner with my wife. Yeah, see you guys. Yeah, bye for now.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problems. Bye.